And in this part, we are going to do Bluetooth. It says simply Bluetooth, but basically there are three wireless personal area networks, PAN standards, which are very popular. First one is Bluetooth, which all of you have it, right? Second one is Zigbee. Zigbee is what is being used by the smart grid. Zigbee is designed for the sensors. All the sensor networks people use Zigbee. Okay? And the third one is UWB, which is the ultra wideband. So my problem is if I don't talk about one of them, you know, you really miss, you know, important thing. So I got to talk about all of these. So we'll talk about Bluetooth here, and this is how they fit in. So personal area network is 10 meters or less. Wi-Fi is 100 meters or less. Local area network is 100 meters or less. And in kilometers, we get into metropolitan area networks. And beyond kilometers, we get into wide area networks, right? So we are in this here, PAN, personal area networks. We'll talk about Bluetooth, Zigbee, and something else, right? UWB. So that is how the distance was. In the previously, we showed the distance, but the data rate also changes accordingly. So if you have a very high data rate, generally the distances are low. If you have a low data rate, you can go longer distance, all right? So there's something called distance bandwidth product. So longer distance, less bandwidth, more bandwidth, less distance, and so on and so forth. So this is the thing we are talking about, 15. 15.4 is Zigbee, very low rate, very, very low rate actually. It's very, very low rate. It is less than the Bluetooth. And the range is also not very much. Bluetooth has higher range, but the date is low. And then there is UWB, which has much higher rate. All right, so here we are talking about Bluetooth. Bluetooth has the rate about a megabits. And Zigbee is less than a megabit. And this is hundreds of megabits. If you were to talk about mobility, that's another dimension. And the mobility also changes with the data rate. If you are moving very much, the data rate is low. On the other hand, if you're moving slowly, then you can have a high data rate. So this is high mobility. Vehicular mobility, you don't get very high data rate. So these are the standards that we're talking about mostly are personal area network. There's not much mobility. They're stationary. So all the 15s are stationary. And then as we go into cellular networks, they become highly mobile. So Bluetooth. Now Bluetooth is everywhere. So I don't have to explain to you that the Bluetooth can be used in cell phones. It can be used in speaker phones. It can be used in gaming devices. Right? So that is kind of common. It gives you 720 kilobits to 10 meters. That's how far it goes and what the speed is. And therefore, it competes with infrared. So originally, the computers used to have this infrared port in the back, and you could connect to a printer wirelessly by using infrared. But nowadays, we do Bluetooth. So why is it called Bluetooth? Because it was started by Ericsson, which is a Danish company, so they named it after their famous king, Harald Blåtand. His original name was this, but he was fond of blueberries, so he was called the Bluetooth King. All right, so that's how the name came about. It has nothing to do with the technology, it's just a random name based upon the company that invented it, Ericsson. So what they wanted to do was they wanted to have RF communications between cell phones over short distances. So you have two cell phones, how do you talk to each other? I mean, they could have done infrared, but they wanted to do RF. Infrared is light, and they wanted to do radio. So they started some work in that area, and later on, IBM, Intel, Nokia, everybody else joined it, and they formed a special group called Bluetooth SIG. So just like Wi-Fi, this is an organization, a special interest group. So Bluetooth organization. So they met at that place, under that organization, and then they came up with a specification in 99. And then they took it to IEEE. So here is what happens. Sometimes the standard is first done in IEEE and then it goes outside. In case of 11, for example, it went to Wi-Fi. In case of WiMAX, it first was 16 and then it became WiMAX. But in case of Bluetooth, the standard was already done outside, and then they brought into IEEE to get it a standard name. So that came out, was approved in 2002. It took 3 years after that, basically, to follow all the IEEE things. And the key features are low power, so it doesn't take too much power, and it is not very expensive, and it doesn't take too much space. So it's a very small chip, very cheap chip, and very low power, so you can have batteries last for a long time. First of all, it works in the same range as 11. So 2.402 to 2.480, this is exactly the band that 802.11 uses, and the total of 79 megahertz band. So while 802.11 uses only 20 megahertz channels, right? This one uses the whole band and frequency hops. So if it frequency hops, there are 79 frequencies at 1 megahertz apart. In some countries, there are 23 megahertz available, so the frequency hop in those 23 megahertz. Okay? And it gets you 1 megabit total nominal, and the net is 720. So what happens is when you hear the rate such as 11 megabits or 54.4 megabit, these are bit rates at rate which the bits are sent, but you know there is a weight, there is a gap, and so on and so forth, there is a collision, and so the effective rate generally is much less than the what we call the nominal rate. So this is basically tells you the size of the bit is 1 megabit per second, right? But by the time you take care of other overheads, you get more like 720 kilobits per second for the user. Channel bandwidth is 1 megahertz, up to 10 meters can be extended. So basically it goes up to 10 meters and you can go longer by higher power. With the normal power it is 10 meters. And as I said, it is frequency hopping 1600 times per second. So it remains at one frequency for 625 microseconds. It means that one frequency and then hops to the next frequency and then hops to the next frequency. So you remember frequency hopping, right? The spread spectrum technique, right? There were two spread spectrum techniques. One was frequency hopping, another one was direct sequence. So this one uses frequency hopping. And it has a 128-bit encryption and challenge response authentication. So what is challenge response authentication? So normal authentication is a password. We say, what is your password? You give the password and then we verify that that's the right password. But the problem with that is that, anybody can probably replay it or can probably listen to your password unless it is also encrypted. So there are ways to get rid of that problem. And one simple way is to do challenge response, where we send you a challenge. You say, okay, all right, whatever your password is, with that, please encrypt this number. And then you use your password to encrypt the number. When the number comes back to me, I can do the same thing, and I have your password, so then we can verify that, yeah, your password is correct. So that is called challenge response. No password is exchanged. A random challenge is sent to you, and then you have to send a response to that random challenge. And that way you cannot replay it. Why it cannot be replayed? Because the challenge is every time different. Right? So even your password has not changed, because the challenge is different, the response will come out different. All right, and then power-wise, there are three classes, class 1, 2, and 3. Class 3 has the lowest power, which is 0 dBm. How much is 0 dBm? 1 milliwatt. And a higher power is 4 dBm class 2 and 20 dBm is class 1, and they can go longer just because they have more power. You should read, you can read one of these three pages referred here for more details, but today I have added actually the Wikipedia page too, and that is very good actually, I found. One device acts as a master and other devices act as slaves. So it turns out that this shows you the age of the standard. We no longer use the word slave anymore in any networking protocols. We call them primary and secondary. The new terminology would be, we have one primary station, our master station is fine, but then you will have secondary stations. Anyway, so there are seven slaves here. And the reason one is master is because that is acts like a base station. So it basically coordinates the whole thing. Generally, in most communication that you're using Bluetooth, there are only two stations. I mean, you're talking to one cell phone to another cell phone, or from one cell phone to your computer. So whoever is more powerful generally becomes the master, and the other one becomes the slave, and the master controls everything. So anyway, so up to seven active slaves. So one, so for example, if you have one computer which has Bluetooth in it, it could be talking to seven devices. It could be talking to a printer. It could be talking to your phone. It could be talking to some other device, right? So that's what it is, seven active slaves and 255 parred slaves, up to 255. So the total is actually 256 only. So basically 255 is total actually. So basically what it is that you can have up to 255 nodes in a network, in a PicoNet as we call it, and all of them could be parked, or some of them could be active. Up to seven can be active. So parked means they're sleeping, right? And so they're not really losing any battery power that way. Active slaves are polled by the master for transmission. So seven slaves which are active, they're continuously polled. Do you have anything to send? 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 And if you have something to send, you say yes, and then we give you opportunity, and the master gives you opportunity to speak. Right? That's why it is called the master, because a slave cannot just speak by itself. It has to wait until the master asks, do you want to speak? And you say yes, and then you speak. All right? Each station gets an 8-bit parked address, and that's why the limit is number of parked addresses, because the address is 8-bit. And so when you join the network, you get an 8-bit number, and you say, well, you are number 15, you are number 233, and so on and so forth. So you get an 8-bit address, and then if you are parked, means you are sleeping, you can come back in 2 milliseconds, whereas if you are just coming in fresh into the room, it will take longer than 2 milliseconds. So when you come, you join the PicoNet and go to sleep. If you want to speak because you have a traffic, then you come back to active stations. A device can participate in multiple PicoNets, and that is the complex schedule. So while this feature is more like a theoretical feature, where one device could be talking to two different masters. So it is there, but I haven't seen it happening in practice. All right? So in practice, we generally have two devices at most, maybe seven, maybe that would be already too much. But this is how it works. Actually, the if you don't count the master, then 255 plus one. Master is plus one.
Okay, thanks.
Because you need 8-bit addresses, so if all zero address would be the master, and then you have 255 others. So that is the total. And if some are active, some are parked, all of them could be parked. So the next slide talks about how does the frequency hopping work. So we already have done this frequency hopping thing, but we will see an exact implementation in Bluetooth. So the way frequency hopping works is that there are many frequencies to which we randomly switch. Every 625 microseconds, the frequency is switched using a pseudo-random number generator, right? So So with a pseudo random generator, if you have the formula and I have the formula, and we can put a seed into that formula, same seed, we will get the same number. Put the same number again, you get the same number again and again. So we will get exactly the same sequence, even though it is random sequence. But if we start with the same formula for generator, and we start the same seed, we will get the same number, right? So both of us, or all of us, will know exactly what frequency we are working in this slot. Alright, so we go from frequency to frequency to frequency. Every 625 microsecond, we change the frequency. Well, okay, we don't change frequency every 625. These slots are 625 microseconds, so we could potentially change the frequency every 625 microseconds, but if we start a transmission and if it is multiple slots, then we continue on that frequency. That's the thing. So it uses time division duplexing, bidirectional communication. And what are the two different ways to do bidirectional communication? FDD, one is frequency, one is time, right? TDD is time. So in time basically means half duplex, you know, in some sense, right? You speak half the time, or, you know, or not half the time. When I am speaking, you're not speaking. When you're speaking, I'm not speaking, like that, right? So this is the TDD. Downstream and upstream alternate. Master starts in the even numbered slots only. So the slots are numbered. So if you have 0, 1, 2, and so on and so forth, so the master will speak only in the even numbered slots. The slave starts in the odd numbered slots only. And LSB of the clock indicates even or odd. So there is a clock. And whenever the least significant bit is 0, that means it is even. When it is 1, it is odd, right? Slaves can transmit one slayer right after receiving a packet from the master. So here is a master speaking, and this is the slave speaking. So you see, the slave can speak right in the next slot. So actually, this is just the next slot, not one slot gap, just next slot. Then packets are either one slot long, three slot long, or five slot long. So the packets could be, this is one slot packet, this is three slot packet, and this is five slot packet. Shown here, okay? The frequency hop is skipped during a packet. So we change the frequency every 625 microseconds unless you are transmitting a packet. So in the middle of the transmission, you don't change. So if you are transmitting here, basically the master is receiving. In that case, both of you don't change the frequency, right? But once the transmission is over, you change the frequency. Because if you change the frequency in the middle of the transmission, you will lose some time. And that's not very good, right? So we don't change it during the transmission. Otherwise, we change every slot. Okay.